welcome to this session.
Yeah, and the purpose of this webinar is to give the audience an idea of what RPA is, what it offers as a technology, and how transformation managers can look to implement RPA solutions in their own enterprises.
So before we start with this webinar, a couple of hygiene checks and protocols for this session. We would request all the participants and attendees to be on mute. Any questions that they might have, they are free to post them in the comment and chat section. The last 15 minutes of this webinar will be dedicated for any question answering that would be there. So we are more than happy to take up any queries that you have. In case we run short of time, we will revert to you with the answers.
Over. Please feel free to reach out to our marketing team with your questions or queries that you may have, and we will be happy to get back to you. Okay. Without any further ado, we'll start off. So this is a quick look at the agenda today. So we are going to walk you through what RPA is, how we expect RPA to be a disruptive technology, why it is important to adopt RPA in modern organizations. Then we will move over to some kind of overview of the RPA architecture. We'll take you through a couple of case studies. We will walk you through some industry use cases, just to give you an idea of where RPA could be implemented. To close out the session, we would discuss a bit about the takeaways that we've gained with our prior experience over the last 2 years with regard to RPA implementations. And lastly, what is needed for an organization to ensure the success and viability of an RPA project. So let's get started.
First things first, Arun, what do you think is RPA, and is it all about physical robots?
Yeah, Sanjana, good question. So we found that in a couple of interactions with some potential interested prospects, RPA has come across as people have understood RPA that it's kind of a physical robot, which would be, moving around warehouses, performing tasks and activities. But let us be very clear at the onset that RPA has nothing to do with physical robots. It's purely software-based automation. It's just a piece of logic which will be mimicking human rules, human actions, keystrokes on software systems and help human beings achieve more with automation. So RPA is a technology, is a software, which is suited for repetitive, rule-based activities, mechanical tasks and actions, which do not really require human intelligence, which do not require human judgment and decision-making. And wherever there is a condition, if that condition is pre-coded for the RPA software bot, the bot will be able to take care of the decision workflow. But in essence, RPA is just a set of instructions, a set of programming logic, which a bot will follow in order to complete workflows.
A few factors that we need to keep in mind that come as a result of an RPA project. The first one being security. Is RPA secure? Is there a chance of data leak? Is there a chance of data compromise? Is there a chance of losing out some kind of critical information or deviation from preset rules and precedences? The answer is no. The technology in itself is non-invasive. It sits on top of your existing IT infrastructure and ensures that it does not capture, host, hold any form of data or information that is sensitive to your project or process. It merely makes sure that a process over an IT ecosystem is expedited in the most efficient and fast manner. And in that term, it ensures the security and the compliance adherence to the process framework.
Let's not forget the advantage of accuracy also here, because whenever a human worker may be performing a task, we may try to avoid errors, but it might creep in inadvertently. So with a bot, you eliminate the chance of error completely, because it's just a piece of software given a set of instructions which it has to perform, and it'll keep performing those steps repeatedly again and again without fail, without error, till it is scheduled to do so. So you are looking at near 100% accuracy levels for any RPA project of implementation.
Another very interesting feature, Arun, about an RPA project is optimization. And what levels of optimization are we looking at? We are looking at optimization of process. We are looking at optimization of time.
Right.
We are looking at optimization of resources. And with resources, I mean full-time equivalents, licenses, softwares, and hardwares.
And even infrastructure-based resources, right?
Absolutely. So the idea is to create a digital workforce which resides within your IT ecosystem,
mm-hmm.
and makes sure those entry-level routine and mundane tasks are expedited in the most efficient manner without consuming too much of investments for this particular project.
So it's like a centrally operated software system, an automaton, which will work across applications, which can traverse from SAP to Microsoft to Windows without any breaks, without any faults. And it is centrally operated, so the process team or the support team will be having a centralized view of all operations scheduled for that bot. At any and every point of time, it will be able to track the bot operations. It will be able to fetch performance logs and find out where the bot has been able to accurately perform a task and where in the workflow, if there might be any errors has happened, they might be tracking the errors and find out how to move the process ahead. So you are getting a centralized view of operations and you're getting a centralized tracking as well.
In terms of robustness, an RPA project not only depends upon the tool and the technology that you're using, but also the designing that is involved in that project. In terms of tools, we have some leading tools like Automation Anywhere, UiPath, Blue Prism, Kofax out in the market, and many more. In fact, there are bespoke boutique tools available as well. But the main idea that needs to be pondered upon is, what is the effort that is going in the identification of the process? How are we conceiving and conceptualizing that process through an RPA? And how well are we making that process robust through repetitive and continuous improvement?
Right. So moving ahead, let's move on to the next slide. The question is, how disruptive is RPA? So what do you have to say about it?
Disruption paints a picture of a big explosion in my mind.
Yeah.
But is it as serious, as grave as that is? The answer is yes and no. Yes, in terms of the kind of difference that it makes to the work, and no, in terms of the investment or change that it looks at.
Right. So basically, RPA is a common industry buzzword. Over the last couple of years or 3 years, it has really picked pace and momentum. Organizations worldwide has started implementing RPA or are already in advanced stages of RPA implementations. Let me tell you, Sanjana, there are several banks in which over 1,000, 2,000 bots are currently working and taking care of entire financial workflows. So looking at it from an adoption point of view, yes, RPA is new, but also not new, in that organizations have already evaluated RPA and they have seen that there are benefits to be gained out of it. And right now, several organizations are already in advanced stages of the RPA maturity journey.
In fact, as we move over to the next slide, we'll see what our industry pioneers have to say about RPA. What is interesting to note is, where are we as organizations in this race of transformation?
Right. If you look at some of the numbers here, so it's Gartner says that 30 to 40% of our existing business process services are likely to be impacted by RPA. So you're looking at immediate productivity gains on the table. It's just a question of grabbing the opportunity, grabbing the potential for automation through RPA, and going about it in the right manner. So that is also important. You may make the decision to adopt RPA, but you also need to have a comprehensive and well-thought-out plan how you are going to achieve the desired results. And I think that's something which we are going to touch upon a few slides in the end, right?
Absolutely. In fact, the idea is to see and rethink how we are working and how we can work better. So if we can spend 5 minutes of our office time in yoga while some kind of processing is happening in the back end through an RPA bot, don't you think it's a great thing?
I would love coming to office every day. If my mundane work were being taken
Absolutely.
Over, I would have a digital assistant by my side. So
that's the right word, in fact, Arun, a digital assistant. And trust me, all of us need that one digital assistant for us to help us do all these routine tasks in a faster, in a more efficient manner, rather than eating up into our bandwidths to do those things.
Right. That would free up our time to look at, you know, say, exception-based use cases, exception cases of, you know, maybe wherein a human touch is required to interact with a customer. You need to respond personally, or you need to really look into what the problem is, and you need to come up with some judgment-based decisions that require a manual intervention. Otherwise, the rest of the stuff, I think 30-40% of what we are doing on a daily basis is purely mechanical, purely robotic, and giving it to a software robot is the right thing to do.
Absolutely. And the whole idea is to bring about consolidation.
Right.
Looking at what McKinsey has to say, just imagine 140 million FTEs could be replaced by digital workers. So this is just not restructuring how we do operations, but also bringing in a great degree of consolidation by removing all the non-value-adding things in day-to-day work.
Right. Move on. Let's. So this is a bit about the architectural overview. So RPA solutions are very versatile and flexible in that there is a host of ways in which you can deploy and implement RPA solutions. So organizations can look at on-premise installations where it is individual desktops or laptops which become the platform for RPA solutions. You can look at implementing RPA solutions through virtual machines, VMs, and in the most advanced of implementations, you can look at a cloud-based model. So the products, the RPA products which are available are seamlessly, can be seamlessly integrated with cloud services like Azure and the other industry-leading cloud services, Amazon Web Services and all. And if you look at the top of this slide, we are looking at different applications on which RPA can work. So we are looking at enterprise-level software like SAP, Microsoft Dynamics, QADs. We are looking at Microsoft Office Outlook. We are looking at Salesforce CRMs. We are even looking at legacy applications like mainframes and AS400s. And last but not the least, open source systems such as Java and .NET-based applications are also good candidates, are also applications on which RPA solutions can be implemented. So just this slide gives you an idea of how versatile and how flexible the software bot really is.
In fact, when I look at this slide, there is another interesting and increasing trend that I see. From on-premise to cloud, just imagine the degree of independence that you're achieving in your process and the degree of risk that you're hedging. So
right.
When you are on cloud and you're expecting RPA in terms of bot as a service, just imagine that you don't have to bear enough cost on the infrastructure. You do not have to bear the risk of, you know, a system going down and the need for a BCP to be invoked, because everything's out there on cloud. And of course, there's something else that can start off if your primary section goes down.
So we are looking at enhanced, you know, HADR options as well.
Absolutely.
Okay.
So the main idea behind this architecture overview was to make the audience comfortable with the idea that this is something that does not need to get ingrained or integrated within your IT system by disturbing it in any fashion. Sorry about that. The idea would be to make it stay as a layer on top of what you have and make sure that your system, the underlying IT system, is working to its full potential.
Absolutely. Moving on. We are going to walk you through a couple of use cases that we've implemented at JK Technosoft. The first one is a retail-based use case, which Sanjana will walk you through, and the second one is a real estate-based use case.
Do you know, Arun, why this use case is so interesting?
Why?
This is the use case about the first RPA project that JKT undertook, and this is by far one of the most successful projects that we have delivered. The client is a leading multinational FMCG giant. We were running a huge project with them wherein reporting was done from data across 13 different systems. There was problem in terms of the delivery time, in terms of the data transformation that was happening, errors in the report, causing discrepancies in strategic decision making. So as a result, we were not able to deliver the kind of services that JKT usually ensures all its clients. So what did we do to solve this problem? So our digital innovation wing came up with this novel idea of offloading this task over to digital workers, which are our RPA bots. So we built bots which were able to front-end these applications, extract the data using secure means, run the standardization rules, clean the data, and then apply the rules to generate those bespoke reports and post it to the operations team.
And how many different applications were involved in this?
Around 13 plus different IT systems.
So you're saying the data was being extracted from different applications, massaged, transformed, and finally produced to the desired state.
Absolutely. With the degree of roll up and drill down that is expected of any report. So the data that we were able to structure through this project was really, really meaningful to the organization. They were able to derive a lot of good information out of that data, and they were able to meet the requirements of their metrics meetings on time. This solution not only brought about the ease and seamlessness of the processing, it also reduced the dependency on full-time equivalents. So as you can see on your screen, around 78% of automation was unattended, leaving only 22% behind, which required some form of approval mechanism from people. In fact, as we speak, our experts, our RPA experts at this client site are working to see how they can create that level of abstraction within the bot so that we can achieve around 100% unattended automation. Needless to say, the delivery time was short. There was around 100% accuracy, and of course, optimization of resources, very, very important. We were able to relieve around 17 plus full-time equivalents worth effort. We were able to relieve license costs. We were able to relieve costs of infrastructure and per-seat costs.
Great. Okay. So let's have a look at the second use case. So this one was for an Indian real estate company, and they were struggling with a use case in procurement. So basically, the procurement team was about 8 to 10 members, and looking at hundreds of procurement requests coming in daily, it was getting really difficult for the team to handle multiple requests, and as a result, project execution and delivery times were getting affected. So JKT came up with a solution, an automated solution, in which we looked at a suite of different processes within the procure-to-pay cycle. Look, say, the PR creation, the purchase requisition creation, the purchase order creation, the creation of the service entry, the invoice matching, and the validation. So if we look at it, the portions of the end-to-end workflow of the P2P cycle was completely automated by bots, and it resulted in time savings of around 75%. And what it resulted in was a reduced dependency, so that the procurement team was open to looking at more customer requests wherein there were certain exceptions, wherein there were critical requests that had to be handled manually, whereas the routine requests could be taken up by the robot.
In fact, Arun, if you ask me, if this was my business and if I had to rely on people to handle money, I would really be a little nervous. Because money and finance is something that we cannot compromise on, and it needs to be first time right and as accurate as possible. So what was the degree of confidence boosting that our solution did to this client?
Right. They were really impressed with it, and in fact, they extended the concept of RPA to other processes such as material master management, vendor creations, and other suitable processes. So, you know, once a project gets going and the clients get the necessary confidence and comfort with the product and the solution, they immediately look at, you know, evangelizing the solution within the different departments, and the scope of RPA grows within the organization as a whole.
Right. In fact, what you just spoke of gives us a feeling that this RPA mindset has literally gone from one person to multiple people within this organization.
Right.
Is that right?
Right. It starts small, but it ends up really big.
Excellent.
Okay, so let's have a look at some cross-industry use cases. So we've tried to compartmentalize the use cases based on different business domains. So if you look at the first one, procurement, I think we already covered a bit in the last slide. So elements of the procure-to-pay workflow. If you're looking at bid management, where the bot will be able to collate, organize, and structure multiple bids for the bid management team. You can also have the bot look at data accuracies or false of the data in Excel-based bid templates, which can be identified by the bot. And also, this can be extended to elements in the tender and contract verification as well. Looking at BFSI, the finance-based use cases, elements of account receivables, payables can be taken up by the bot. We can look at monthly and quarterly reconciliations, wherein, if there are several entities working within an organization and you need to do a quarterly reconciliation of the expenses and costs. And, believe me, Sanjana, we were working with a client over such a use case, and the volume of data that enterprises need to handle for such reconciliations is really immense. And that is where they struggle to deal with the data, they struggle to errors creep in the Excel reports, and ultimately it eats up a lot of FTE effort in order to produce really accurate and timely reports. So if such a use case, which is so data heavy and so time consuming, can be handed over to a bot, I think it really brings immense benefits to an organization.
In fact, you'll be happy to know that one of the leading business magazines I was going through quoted that data is the new oil. That means to say how expensive and how important data has become in today's day.
Right.
So just imagine the degree of sensitivity and carefulness that needs to be there in order to handle and nurture this data into something more meaningful, which is what we are doing through RPA.
Every error is a cost to the
process.
Absolutely. Okay. Moving on to the HR space, you can manage employee master data. You can handle end-to-end recruitment. So an employee who is joining an organization needs a certain set of accesses, privileges granted. And you have multiple teams ranging from the HR, the admin, the IT, networking teams who need to be involved, who need to coordinate, communicate with each other in order to get a single person onboarded. Why not have this task taken over by a bot, centrally operated, who will be communicating with the various teams if needed? But the final objective for the bot will be to give the entire set of accesses required for one person.
So what you're saying is, tomorrow when five freshers join my team, their entire onboarding process in terms of the HR department, in terms of creating their network IDs, things
LAN
that are
IDs,
required
yeah.
for the IT compliance, etc., will be taken care of by the bot itself?
Absolutely. That is what we're doing for a manufacturing client in India.
So all that we need to do is just sign on it?
Sign on it and put a welcome sign for the new freshers.
So that's the effort we have to put.
Right.
And that's nothing doing away with it.
Right. Okay. So use cases from IT and security would involve use of dip provisioning and provisioning. You could also look at network monitoring, wherein you need to maybe monitor the availability of your IT network across your operating locations. So instead of having a support team spending nights, sleepless nights monitoring the connections, we can have a bot monitor the connections and notify the support team if required. So this frees up bandwidth, it creates a comfort for your employees, and you overall the process becomes just much simpler.
Mm-hmm.
Right? And coming to the end, customer engagement. So this is more of a, interactive, email interactive use case in which, the bot can respond to customer status requests. Maybe you don't need to monitor your portal for simple, straightforward requests. Maybe the status of a purchase requisition, whether it is held up, whether it has been approved or not. Why not send just an email to the bot with your purchase requisition number? The bot will query SAP, fetch the details with regard to that particular purchase order, and get back with the complete information. Send a mail back to the requester. So these kind of interactive requests could be taken over by the bot as well.
Excellent.
Okay, moving on.
So I think this again is a couple of
A
few things that we have put across as a trigger or a food for thought in order to see where all automation works best. this again is a very, very small subset of use cases. And in fact, by now, what we generally do with our clients is we ask them, what is your pain point? Are you aware of your pain points? How sensitized are you in the kind of effort and money that you are spending doing things that can be automated? So every good business analyst in today's day is writing his or her story in terms of use cases and reports, and the internet is flooding with these information. But what I feel is more important over here is for every individual from every business function to identify what are those pain problem points mm-hmm. that they are facing, and whether RPA can actually make some kind of an improvement over it, can add some value to it. So over here, the idea behind having an RPA is not just to go randomly and automate processes.
Yeah.
Is it bringing you the kind of comfort that you expect from the process? Point number one. Point number two, is it bringing improvements to what you're expecting? Point number three, is it gelling well with the upstream and downstream of your processes? So these are very, very important, and we all need to start thinking from this perspective in order to make an RPA project successful.
Right, an application study is essential before starting off any RPA project. You need to know where the pain points, where the issues, real issues are in organizational workflows, and come up with a strategic, you know, plan to automate maybe 70 or 80% of the workflow. In some cases, automating the entire workflow may not be feasible. You maybe need to look at 70, 80% automation, but that will also help organizations derive, you know, substantial benefits.
In fact, the other day, our technical architect was saying, the success of the RPA project that we are undertaking completely depends on the effort that we are putting in the conceptualization phase
right.
of this project.
Right.
So if we have incubated the design, the approach in the right manner, there is a chance of 100% and more success from an RPA project.
Okay, moving on. So these are some takeaways from some RPA implementations that we undertook. We'll go over the first point. So the first point says process selection. I think Sanjana covered it a bit in the last slide. Before even starting off with an RPA project, you need to identify the right set of processes for automation. There are several processes which may seem to be good candidates, but once into the project, it might come up, there might be several roadblocks which actually delay or even, you know, sabotage the entire RPA implementation. So it is absolutely necessary to conduct a feasibility study. And you need to look at processes which are time-consuming, which are repetitive, which are rule-based, you know, which are prone to human errors. Because not only are you looking at improving a process, automating the process needs to provide you with the required benefit, required ROI. Otherwise, the automation is really not worth it, right? The second point that we have is optimize before automating. So as Sanjana rightly said, we should not go ahead and blindly automate processes. We need to look at points in the workflow which can be optimized, workflows which can be re-engineered, or maybe, you know, couple of workflows combined into one single workflow before starting off with the automation.
In fact, an RPA project has the ability to derive a lean design and Six Sigma, which is an ask for any huge operation.
Yeah.
So it's important that we do this task very, very carefully and very judiciously in order to derive at an optimal solution and design. The next thing again is something quite related to the first two points, visible and measurable design approach, involving the right stakeholders, the process owners, the experts to see what we need to see as part of the next gen of a process. So it's just not that the process is maturing in bits of having RPA, in having AI or ML, but as a whole, where is that process? Is it complete success end-to-end? Is it patchy in places, in strands? All these are things that we will have to consider before we start measuring the design approach.
Right.
And of course, related to this is the dependency study.
Right.
Where is the process? How is it connected to the upstream
how
and the downstream?
The interfaces, you know, and whether automating a process will have impact on other processes which interface with it. So you need to do a complete process dependency study too, in order to, you know, make ensure that your RPA project has the best chances for success. Coming to the ending points of this slide, visualize before implement. Again, you need to have a very clear idea. You need the technical plan, the solution design. Everything has to be reviewed multiple times and approved by all the stakeholders in order to ensure that there are no surprises towards the end. We should also involve all stakeholders. I mean, this is a very important point. End users of the process architects, and the technical team. These three stakeholders need to be completely involved during all stages of the project, and there needs to be a really, agile feedback loop in which you are taking into account every comment and feedback from all these stakeholders. Because at the end of it, that is what will ensure that the process that you are automating is robust and sustainable. And lastly, reusable modules. You want to take this up?
In fact, it is important to build small chunks rather than having a block approach of building bots. A block approach is something that needs a little additional effort to model and remodel. But once you have functions broken up into tasks and each task coded as small plug-and-play modules, it makes it easy to reuse them
and
in
scale up. And even scale up.
And the cost and the time involved in doing the development goes down as well. So it has a cascading effect. In fact, it's very interesting to note that last year when we were speaking about RPA, it was RPA as a technology. Today when we talk about it, it is more of business process optimization and management through traditional technologies and modern technologies like RPA and AI.
Absolutely. So it needs to be a holistic approach.
Absolutely.
Okay. So this slide is intended to give the audience an idea of what mindset changes are required and what kind of initiatives need to be taken organization-wide in order to make an RPA project successful. You need to be very clear about the end results. You need to be very clear about the way you are going to achieve the end result. So the documentation, the structuring of the process, the realization of the solution has to be very clear and approved by all stakeholders. There is absolutely a very great need for collaboration, because during any RPA project, you will find that it requires involvement of various teams.
Yes.
Okay.
In fact, to add to this point, I'll narrate a small incident. I was running this RPA project with another leading drug manufacturing company in India, drug and medicine manufacturing company. And the CFO over there was addressing his team, the core RPA team, the COE that we have built today. And the first thing he said over there is, these bots are not your competitors. These are your helpers. So please try to put in the support that is required.
Absolutely. You're looking at also the levers of drive, flexibility, and openness, in which for an RPA project, for an organization which is new to RPA, there might be initial resistance, there might be initial hesitation on the part of the end users as to what impact RPA will have on their day-to-day activities. So that is where I think transformation managers and leaders need to create a sense of openness and trust within the team to ensure that the project runs smoothly and, create that sense of urgency, because as is work, business as usual goes on.
Absolutely.
So you are not looking at creating a new organizational process through RPA. It is existing processes that you are automating, so which could very easily be continued in the old way. But why you intend to bring RPA, that is the kind of drive and, the initiative that needs to be created within all project teams working together.
The functional motto needs to get,
right,
coupled with the organization's motto and
right,
individual's motto as well.
Right. And during RPA project implementations, you may find that whatever was, agreed upon at the inception of the project may not work out. There may be a need to change your plan, your action plans. There may be a need to re-engineer the to-be workflow in order to, complete the project. So that is where an organization needs to be very flexible and open to change, because the ultimate objective is automation. And we need to be very compliant and very flexible enough to do whatever it needs to make the project a success. I think RPA stands at a convergence of people, processes, and practices, and that is where, you know, that sense of openness, that sense of integration needs to be brought in.
It's like building a bridge.
Right.
The stronger the foundation is, the longer the bridge will sustain. So it is important that there is openness within people about the technology. There is awareness about the technology within people. There are a lot of industry speculations and fads that, you know, automation, AI is going to pick up jobs, is going to cut down the jobs that's out there in the market, and a lot of other things related to labor arbitrage, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. What we need to focus on and, I would say, isolate is the problem and not think about what can what effect it can have. What is the problem at hand and how are we dealing with that problem? If RPA is a solution, then RPA should be brought in. If RPA is not a solution, then we need to park it for the time being. So all this requires a lot of analysis, a lot of, I would say, brainstorming, which needs to be done.
Absolutely.
I think this brings us to the end of this.
End of our presentation, but I think we have some questions.
Yes, now we are opening up this session for any questions that you might have. Please feel free to post in the queries that you have.
So I have a question coming in, which says, how do you select a process for RPA? So there are primary identifying criteria which makes a process a good candidate for automation. First, just straight off my mind, is the process repetitive? How much time it is consuming, and if it is rule-based. So if it passes these three major criteria, I think the initial set of filtering is done, and you can move on to the, you know, the subsequent steps wherein you need to engage with the process team and understand the benefits that can be realized through RPA.
Right. In fact, again, it brings us to the point where one needs to be very, very aware and sensitized about the problems that they have. So the more you know that these are the roadblocks that we have, these are the things that are not working as it should, that would give you that additional food for thought to see if RPA could be a solution, or for that matter, it could be any other technology.
Right. So I'm also getting a question. What's the, you know, time taken to implement an RPA project?
I think it varies from process to process, from scale to scale, from complexity to complexity.
Right. On an average, what would you say? I think a medium complex process would be around
1.5 months.
4 to 6 weeks, yeah.
See, for people who are new to the idea of RPA, this is their maiden journey, they will have to put in that additional time to evaluate and to conceptualize the concept with respect to the processes. For people who have started this, have done, you know, proof of concepts and values before, they need to see what is it that they are targeting and how soon they want it. So there are a lot of factors which determine a duration, and of course, based on the skills of your consultants.
Yeah.
That's very, very important, actually. So how many consultants do you wish to bring in? Who are these consultants and what kind of experience they have? That also makes a very big difference.
Big difference, I know. Okay, so I think...
another question that's coming in. So the question is, how flexible is an RPA project? Now, I mean, this is pretty generic.
You need to be flexible. So any RPA project, there obviously needs to be certain artifacts, certain, objectives in place before you start it off. But... having said that, if there are some unprecedented conditions coming in which were not thought of initially, one needs to be flexible enough to modify certain bits of the workflow, make it easy for the bot to operate, and ultimately not lose the objective of automating it.
See, I think, Arun, flexibility is a very, very generic and a very big term. There could be a lot of nuances to flexibility. In terms of operations, if you are on-premise with a bot, if there is some kind of a shutdown, if there is a crash, how do you move over to the other system as HA and DR? In case you are on a bot as a service, how do you ensure that you are shutting on from one demand and, you know, scaling up to another demand? So all this are also aspects of flexibility. Probably what we would request is this question coming whoever has posted this question, if that person can elaborate on exactly what he or she is looking at in terms of the point of flexibility, we would be more happy to revert back with a detailed answer. Any more questions, please feel free to post it. We have another 3-4 minutes into this webinar. So any closing comments from you, Arun?
So closing comments, I would just like to say that there is a universal need for faster execution and operation today.
Mm-hmm.
There are rising costs for process and customer retention. You need to address that. And there's a need for first-time right.
Mm-hmm.
And RPA is a technology which can help you address all three of these aspects.
Mm-hmm.
So one needs to be open enough, flexible enough, and you need to be, think ahead of your competitors mm-hmm. in order to truly give your organization an edge in this landscape.
And where do you see RPA 5 years down the line?
I would see step-level automation, process automation being very routine
mm-hmm.
in that period of time. But it would also be majorly coupled with elements of cognitive AI, in which the bot gains more decision-making power, abilities, and, taking up even more of your workload.
Absolutely. In fact, down the line, we see this building up into something more smart in terms of a virtual assistant. So now we have a virtual assistant which is pretty, follows your orders, per se. But by that time, we will have these virtual assistants who would know, or rather
who would suggest benefits.
Yeah, absolutely. And coupled with the, concepts of analytics and AI, they would be able to predict things as well. So why is it that we should be stuck with traditional ways of doing things when the competitors would have probably evolved into something more advanced and up to industry standards? So as we spoke before, it's about a race and where we are in the race and how we can benefit from this transformation. I think there are a few more questions coming in. But unfortunately, we have run short of time.
We will respond to those questions.
Yeah, so we are going to respond back to those questions. We have the email IDs of these guys. And if you have any further questions post this webinar, if you want to go back and revisit this webinar, please feel free to find it on our website, jktech.com. And any questions, kindly route to marketing@jktech.com. Having said that, we hope that you enjoyed this session. We hope that it was useful to you.
Yeah, thank you everyone for joining in. It was a pleasure.
Thank you everyone, and we wish you a very, very good evening.
Goodbye.